So we do have one question from Nitish Surana. So
Yes.
his question goes like, should one report to authorities when you come across a data leak on platforms like Shodan, Census, Binary Edge? How bad can it be?
Okay. So usually what happens is that, like, especially for binary age, I think they whenever before publishing something, they directly report it to appropriate owner of a breach. Like, if they are able to attribute, they will usually report. But yes, I think that is definitely a good practice. Like, for example, if you find a data breach, some sensitive information being leaked, and if you could identify who this data belongs to, then it is a good practice that you contact the security team of that organization and report as soon as possible. Also, if you feel that it is the data belong to some to a government or state-based organization, then it is a good practice to reach out to the computer emergency response team, CERT, of that country and report the data breach as soon as possible. I hope that answers the question. Any other question?
No, we don't have any other question for now.
Okay.
Folks, if you all have any question, please feel free to post it on the Q&A. And if you're on YouTube, then you can post there as well.
Sure. I think I mean, even after the session, if anyone has any question, or if you see a recording of this session and you have some questions regarding data security, do feel free to reach out to us or to me personally as well. I am available on Twitter, as well as you can mail me at abhishek@appsec.com. I think I forgot to add that. I will.
So Nitish has a follow-up comment
Yes.
on it. He says that the organization doesn't have dedicated email to report. So what do you do in such cases?
I don't think there is a generic solution for that. Personally, what I would do is probably look up that organization, maybe LinkedIn or some company address book, and try to reach out to some senior technical authority in that organization, like CISO or maybe some CTO or someone, and send him a mail first, telling him or her that I think there is some data breach affecting your organization, and ask for permission first that would you like to receive the full details over mail. And once the person confirms, you should go ahead and share whatever details you have.
Hi Abhishek, I think the talk was really awesome.
Thank
You
you.
covered a lot of things. I mean, I just began into security, like it's been 1 full year now. So initially I started off with Shodan. So I
Okay.
came across a lot of databases and like I was unable to find a proper point of contact. And many times I found many startups who have exposed MongoDB instances and stuff. So what I did was, like, first I will try to fetch them through Twitter. If not Twitter, then I'll go for LinkedIn. Then I'll just be Google Docing to find the right person of interest, and then I will share the thing. Now many startups have successfully, like, mitigated it, and they really care about it. But in many instances, like, I cannot even tell. They were like, "We don't care. You do whatever you want to do."
Yeah, that's the
And
thing.
the sad part is, like, there are many IT implications as well. Like, somebody can easily sue me if I am accessing their data unauthorized without their
Yes.
permission. So, like, this is really a big cloud which is already there but has not been resolved successfully.
So it's a bit of a gray area on the legal side of things. While I'm not an expert on what is allowed and what is not allowed, I think it totally depends on the law of the specific country where the server is hosted.
Yes.
Okay. And most of the large companies, they are open to people reporting issues to them. Even if they don't have a bug bounty program or a specific cert, they are open to people because it's by reporting to them, you're basically helping them.
Yes, exactly.
But yeah, there is no well-defined, there's no standard process. Large organizations have their internal certs, but for startups, it's not really a priority always. They have other.
I mean, there were a few startups to which I reported, and they were really happy about it. They said that, okay, thank you so much. And I was like, okay, you can help me with a Pinterest lab subscription. That would be very kind of you. So, I mean, that was a very positive thing about this. But the reality is a little different, I see.
Yeah.
Because the startups are more like, they really care about their reputation. They really want to make out a name. They don't want to be in the news for some bad thing, right?
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you for asking.
Sorry, I was on mute. Hey, anybody else has questions for Abhishek? Please feel free to ask. We want to make this session as interactive as we can.
Yes. Oh, someone is live tweeting. Awesome. I will retweet as well till the next question comes. So, AppSec Twitter handle is, tweeting a lot of follow-up answers, some of the best practices which our team is aware of. So maybe you can look at Twitter and check out AppSec UK. So if there is no follow-up question, I think we can end the session here. I just want to reiterate that we are doing an office hours next week on 16th July. It's there on hasgeek.com. So if you are looking for specific data security consultation, we are happy to speak to you for free. All you need to do is book a slot for hasgeek office hours next week, and we can have a chat.
I think, Arun, do you have any questions that you want to ask?
Oh, questions, yes. I'll be happy to answer. Arun is saying hi. Hey, Arun, you want to ask something? Then maybe Shruti can unmute you and you can ask directly to me.
Okay, hey, I just gave you permission. You can go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, Abhishek, as I saw, like, it is a pretty interesting topic to see about data breaches. It is really nice. So I have one query here. So I have noticed a lot of people, apart from the bug bounty hunters, who are using a legitimate platform to report certain vulnerabilities. I even noticed a lot of folks who go ahead and report such technical breaches, but it is not part of any of the platforms I've noticed in somewhere in Twitter and other places. So I noticed that they directly contact the company and then they discuss with them and then explain that. Then somehow they are getting in touch with them to basically disclose all these things. But if you notice, that is not a proper channel to do, as far as I'm aware of. Ideally, they have to go to a proper channel. There should be a responsible disclosure program or a platform like HackerOne where they have to disclose it. But I noticed few people directly reaching the company, but sometimes they'll tell like, okay, I'll sue you with some cases of why you did such or pen testing or certain bugs. How did you find it? Who asked you to find it and all? But certain cases they do accept it and then bring upon. So is that approach good enough or should not be done? So what is your views on that?
So in my understanding, like when I started looking at vulnerability search, like finding vulnerabilities, there were no concept of bug bounty. People used to find vulnerabilities just because it was cool. Okay. And people used to report vulnerabilities directly to vendors and to the CVE authority. I think now there are multiple CVE issuing authority. Previously it was MITRE, M-I-T-R-E. So the usual vulnerability disclosure process, which has been there for a long time, is basically reach out to Mitre if you have found a vulnerability in a software product, like say Microsoft Office or say Apache Web Server, some software product. You can ask for a CV and they will do the disclosure. But if you have discovered a security issue in someone's infrastructure, then either you can reach out to them if they have a security contact or a security team with them, or if you're not comfortable, then I think, I'm not very sure, but HackerOne does have some program where they will do the reach out on your behalf. Okay, that is something you have to check. As I said to Nitesh, there is no standard way of vulnerability disclosure. It has always been based on a communication between the person who is reporting and the security team or the cert of that organization. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Yeah.
Awesome.
I feel that it is more like a leap of faith.
Yes.
Like if you talk the right way, if you exactly tell them that, do you have a responsible disclosure program or something? You first you ask this and then you proceed. If they don't have, then you stop there.
Yeah, you can something just ask like them that. Do you have a responsible disclosure program or do you have a security team to which can handle, you know, vulnerability disclosure? Usually people will have that. We can even ask Zainab. Zainab, do you have a security team at HasGeek?
Yes, it's called Kiran.
Okay. So yeah, if you find vulnerabilities on HasGeek infrastructure, you reach out to Kiran at HasGeek.com or ping him on Twitter, JackerHack, right?
So, Abhishek, I have one more query.
Yes.
So for example, say there is a startup, so who are, for example, into a SaaS vendor type of company. So it can be any mode of company you can think of in the IT industry. So as a startup, if at all they face any breaches and they are not aware of like a particular person who exploited or performed that attack, so they are not totally unaware. But in such case, they came to know that, okay, there is something went wrong in their company. So what is the utmost, the first step they have to do? For example, consider that they don't have a big security team, maybe one or two guys may be sitting there. So in such cases, what would be the initial approach a company should take as a startup? Because a lot of startups might not be having idea about security because they are always keen on the deliverables and other things with respect to their product, but not into the security aspect. So what would be the approach they wanted to follow?
Yes. So if you are thinking about this, that means you are already preparing for a potential breach, right? Ideally, everyone should prepare for that. So some kind of incident response practice should be in place. I think there are some incident response playbooks are available. If you feel that there is a breach, I think you should start following an incident response playbook. Usually, like for example, in our infrastructure, what we will do is that we will quickly quarantine the resources that we feel are affected by a breach till we are able to do an investigation and identify a root cause. Okay. If that is not possible from a business perspective, for example, suppose for a SaaS-based company, as an internal team, you suspect that your primary application for your customers has a security vulnerability, which may be exploited. You may not be, because of business reason, take off that application for forensic analysis. Then what I would say is that you deploy some web application firewall or something in monitoring mode and try to inspect the network traffic and figure out the root cause. Ultimately, you have to identify the root cause, identify the extent and impact of the breach, and you have to respond to that, right? If you look at as an example, you can also look at something called NIST cybersecurity framework, right? So they have as part of the NIST cybersecurity framework, there are phases in information security lifecycle. They have this phase called respond and recover. So that talks about what happens if you face a breach. How do you respond to it and how do you recover from it? Does that answer the question?
Yeah. Yeah, sure, definitely. I'll definitely look into that particular NAST. I'm not aware of that one. That they had something with respect to the incident response kind of a thing.
Yeah, but you will find a lot of incident response playbooks out there.
Okay, but basically, if we take a startup, well, the problem would be like, say, the management folks might not be aware of such things. For example, that security aspect of it, like NAST or anything. So in such case, there should be how they are going to approach. Like, is it possible for them to hire someone outside, or because it happened for a startup, a brand new, and they are not aware of security at all sort. So in such case, they should ideally contact a company, or they should go for any. A freelancer kind of a guy who can do such at least the initial analysis for them to find the root cause, at least the incident responder kind of a person they can reach out to. So which one works fine, because basically the startup companies who are not aware of security might not be aware of all these NAST process and other things.
So I think startups, this is again my opinion, startups will take a call based on risk versus gain. For example, if the breach is so impactful that it affects the startup in a severe way, then they should definitely go ahead and hire a professional who can help them in such a situation. Otherwise, what they can do, they can, if it's not that impactful, they can deploy some security control. But in any case, they have to do some kind of analysis to understand what is the root cause. Right, you cannot quarantine or you can take off your entire infrastructure. You have to identify that what was the entry point, what was wrong in some component in your infrastructure, which may have resulted in a breach. Right, only then you can take appropriate action. But yeah, if your customer data is breached, then there is no going back. You have to follow the law of the land. Like in this case, I think in India we don't have the data protection law yet. But when the data protection law comes, if your company is within, is required to, you have to report it to the appropriate data controller. So there is some technical aspect to it and there is some legal aspect to it. There is one more question. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, Abhishek. Yeah.
Great. Thanks.
Abhishek, there's a really interesting question by Aditi.
Yes.
So it says, what measures should journalists take when they report on data breaches? How should they verify whether a breach actually took place, especially if they get an anonymous tip or documents?
Aditi, it's very difficult to actually verify whether a breach is real or not, because there has been many examples of fake data dumps. Like people have created fake data dumps also, right? So I don't think there is a generic way of evaluating whether some kind of a breach is real or fake, because so much PII information is available across the internet. Like if you want PII for Indians, there has been so many breaches in the past, so much data is available. Someone can just take that and create a dump which looks real but may not be real. Right. So I don't know of a generic way to investigate. Maybe security experts can do some correlation, like based on the type of the data and the organization it attributes to, then some kind of correlation may be possible. Again, but again, I don't think there is a generic way to that.
Yeah. Hey, Aditi, go ahead and ask.
Yes. Thanks, Shruti. Thanks for unmuting me. So, Abhishek, I was wondering over there, is it a good idea to verify whether or not that data dump is real or not, whether it's a result of a leak or a breach? Is it a good idea to get in touch with a few people whose names are listed there, maybe their email addresses or phone numbers, and try and verify the kind of information that is there? Maybe just randomly pick up, say, for instance, in journalism, when we report, usually we need corroboration from 2 to 3 sources. So maybe pick up 3 records and get in touch with them. Or would that be an unethical use of PII?
I am not sure. That is, I don't know whether there is some legal concerns on that. I really am not the right person.
I mean, the absence of the PDP bill, law, there's nothing illegal per se.
No, an organization may claim that you have misused their private data.
Okay. Okay.
But again, this is a very great topic because you are doing it without any malicious intent.
Right.
But again, this is very, very technical in terms of, law. I don't think I'm the right person to answer this.
And also, just adding on to what I think Nitish asked earlier, that whom to get in touch with in case of a data breach or if you have knowledge of a data breach. Hmm. So CERT often doesn't acknowledge mails sent to it, the Indian CERT, that is. Okay. So what's the process there, as in, how do we ensure that we are actually doing our due diligence in terms of letting them know that there has been a data breach? We are about to report on it. Can you please plug that loophole first?
Again, I don't think it totally depends on the internal policy. Again, I'm not sure is there a restriction on the legal side, but I'll share something with you. Google has a security research team called Project Zero. They do extensive research on very high value products like, say, Google Chrome or say Internet Explorer, say mobile devices like iOS. I think their researchers only found some critical vulnerability affecting iOS and Android. So they have an internal policy of publicly disclosing technical details of security vulnerabilities after 90 days, after 90 days of informing the appropriate vendor.
Okay,
so in most of the cases, unless it is a very, very high impact issue, like for example, say some iOS issue or some issue related to say TLS library, which affects all browsers, unless it is a high value issue, as far as I know, they have an internal policy of 90 days public release.
Okay, because at least the Indian CERT doesn't seem to have that kind of a policy. And I've spoken to a few people who have tried to inform the CERT about certain issues, never got a response, never got an acknowledgement, the issue doesn't get resolved. And as I don't remember, one of the previous participants also asked that a lot of startups don't respond. A lot of companies don't respond, or there's no way to get in touch with them vis-a-vis vulnerabilities or breaches or supposed breaches. So then it becomes a gray area for us as well while reporting that.
Yeah, without a well-defined law, I think it will be a gray area.
Okay. And while reporting, do you think it's a good idea for the PII to be taken offline first and then publish something, or report it simultaneously? Because that's something we've been grappling with.
So again, I will draw an analogy here. Usually, if I find a vulnerability in a software, say Google Chrome or some popular software, usually it is an ethical practice to report it to the vendor, wait for a patch to be publicly available, give sufficient window for all the users to upgrade to a patched version, a fixed version, and then go ahead with a full technical disclosure.
Okay, and so in case of a data leak or a data breach, what kind of a window would we look at? Because often, until and unless that information goes public through media, people don't get into action.
Yes, exactly. So that is why in software vulnerability research also, full disclosure, like as I said, after a sufficient window, you disclose everything that is known, all the technical details. So full disclosure had always acted as a deterrent for software vendors to act and not ignore security vulnerabilities. Maybe the same is applicable. Maybe the same will apply for data breaches also.
Right. Okay. Thanks, Abhishek. Thanks, Shruti.
Thanks. Happy to help.
Thank you. Okay. So, anybody else who has questions?
I think Ravi has a question. You can unmute him.
Yep. I'll do that. Hi, Ravi.
Yeah. Hi, Abhishek. Yeah. Hi. So just was adding on to the last discussion. So even when someone is trying to publish the technical disclosure, we need a consent from the company which has been affected, right?
Like, yes. See, unfortunately, there is no legally defined way. So it makes sense to not offend the company who has suffered the data breach. So definitely, I would personally go for a permission from the company first before disclosing.
Okay, because in one case this happened that we had found a vulnerability in one of the big companies. We reported to them, they fixed it, And then when we said that you should publish it, and this actually happened twice with big companies, and they said, no, we don't want to actually get it published. And even when we mentioned to them that you should kind of go ahead and tell that you should publish a release on your website saying that your customer data was affected, they kind of denied. So I think in that case, we are more or less out of options. And especially if they are giving you bug bounty reward as well, then...
Oh, yes. See, if they are giving you bug bounty reward, then they are purchasing the right of the rights to that research from you. Then you cannot do anything anyway.
Yeah, without their permission, right? Yeah.
Yes, without their permission anyway, you cannot do, because as part of the bug bounty agreement, I think you are basically selling the research to them.
Yeah. So this happened like twice. So in one of the case, we were not offered the reward. In second, we were. But yeah, from a company perspective or from a security researcher perspective, we actually wanted it to be published because it is their customers who have been actually affected. Someone else might have exploited.
Right.
Is there a way we can convince them to say that, hey, you should go about it? It is not a bad thing that it hits your reputation, but it is a good thing that you come out
no,
and...
There is no way unless the personal data protection bill comes into place, at least in India. I think Aditi will be more familiar with the legal side of things.
I mean, vis-a-vis personal data breaches, there is a responsibility to report. There will be a responsibility to report to the data protection authority, but that's very limited. The bill, unfortunately, does not really address any responsible disclosures, nor does it take into account that these disclosures may be made by third parties. So ethical hackers or security researchers, and what the and where liability would lie or where responsibility would lie in such a case.
Okay.
So, but as per the bill, companies don't have to list, they have to report the breach to the data protection authority, but they don't have to list it on their own website or publicly claim it and or inform their users either.
Okay.
So, which is a concern, to be honest. Yeah.
So in general, there has been very few examples of software vendors actually suing or taking legal measures against security researchers. Mostly software vendors in the West do not do that. Although there has been example of Cisco doing that once, like some during the early days when someone found some serious vulnerability on Cisco routers and they were going ahead and presenting that in a conference. Cisco took a legal route to stop that talk. So that is like a very corner case. Usually that does not happen. Software vendors usually appreciate people reporting their vulnerabilities directly, because otherwise what will happen is that researchers choose to sell their research to the underground, there will be a massive high impact, which software companies usually recognize. But unfortunately, that is not true for data breach. Data breach belonging to some organization.
Just adding to the previous discussion, suppose if you want to really publish your research, you can simply redact whatever that was there. Like for instance, if you are submitting a bug to the US Department of Defense via HackerOne, then you can, like, after the report is closed and it is resolved, then you can request a disclosure where they already, like, they will just simply redact every IP, every URL, everything apart from what actually happened. So that can be a way to approach the company to publish your research and, you know, like, get a name.
Just to add, technically, usually it is, someone who is... has the required skill, they can still figure out from that redacted information. But yeah, what you are saying makes sense. That way, at least the publishing will happen.
There are many bug bounty hunters and researchers who go to Medium and blog about it after getting their permissions.
Right.
So
once you have the permission, then definitely you can do that.
Yes, but then you'll have to again promise them to not to tell anyone.
Okay. Yeah. The bug bounty is a different thing. It's based on policy, not law.
Absolutely.
Anybody has any more questions?
Cool. That was some interesting questions. Like initially, there were no questions from there.
I know, right? Yep. Okay. All right. If nobody has any questions, then I think we can wrap up.
Yes.
But yeah. If you want to ask more questions, yeah, we can wait for a minute or two.
There is a question on YouTube.
Can someone read out the question, please?
Yep. So it says, so it's somebody named VJD. I'm a part of startup. One guy who takes care of security of all natures, be it AppSec, CloudSec, container.
One man security.
Any suggestions? So he's mostly asking for suggestions.
Suggestions on? Hey, Shruti, I can't hear you.
Can you? Me?
Yes.
Yeah, so he's asking for suggestions. Currently, he's trying to implement SAST. So he's asking in for suggestions on that.
Yes. So depending on the technology, there are a bunch of SAST tools. Like if you want to go ahead with free solutions, you can probably look at OWASP.org. Right, Open Web Application Security Project. They have reference to a whole bunch of different SAST security tools, which you can integrate along with your pipeline for security scanning of your code as part of your pipeline.
Yeah, just to add to that, he's also asking if you have any suggestions on threat modeling.
Oh yes, I think threat modeling is definitely very important. As I said as part of my talk, threat modeling is something that I do in order to start my security program, right? Threat modeling is like the visibility that I have for my applications or infrastructure. And threat modeling allows you to see what are the potential threats that are applicable to me. Any security tools that I use or any security process that I bring in is basically to mitigate these threats, right? I will not do anything without a threat model, because if I just follow some random best practice, I may end up mitigating things which is not even applicable to me. So I will definitely start with a threat model. For application security, again, you can refer to the OWASP threat modeling practice. Also, if you want to bring in some threat continuous threat modeling as part of your development process, you can look at Mozilla's rapid risk assessment methodology as well.
Does that answer your question? So he has to say that for a beginner, I just know Stride of Microsoft, but without basics or DFT, it's like shifting left is hellish.
So even OWASP threat modeling can use the Stride methodology. So you have to create DFTs. And on that DFT, you have to apply Stride as a framework for threat enumeration. So Stride is one of the frameworks for threat enumeration.